Hello again and welcome. I'm back with another exciting episode of Spectrum Next Stuff. Today I'm going to be talking about the changes between the issue 2 boards that went out in Kickstarter 1 and the issue 4 boards, or 2H as they are currently known. And there are a number of improvements that have been made between the two generations of board, but nothing has ever really collated those changes into a single place. So I'm going to be talking for about 25-30 minutes on all of these changes, and I'm going to be just broadly showing videos of the two boards. I'm not necessarily going to be pointing out the capacitors, the resistors, the FETs, all of the things that have been added, etc., etc. So the issue 2 board that went out with Kickstarter 1 is lacking in a couple of characteristics. One of those is ESD protection, which is electrostatic discharge protection, and the other one is EMI, electromagnetic interference. There were three major sources of EMI on the Spectrum Next board, and the first one of those is the Wi-Fi module, an ESP01 based on the A266 chip, which I'm showing here, the ribbon cable that connects the daughter board to the main board, as in here, and also the keyboard membrane itself. So the issue 2 board, as was, would not pass any CE testing due to these issues. Many of the interfaces on the issue 2 are legacy 5-volt TTL, that is transistor-to-transistor logic, and CMOS, which is the complementary metal oxide semiconductor. They lack the necessary level translation to the 3.3-volt standards that are supported by the Spartan 6 FPGA. So in the issue 2 boards, series resistors were used to limit voltages and input current when the FPGA maximum of 4.1 volts is exceeded. This isn't ideal in some situations, and too much reliance was placed on the robustness of the FPGA. Admittedly though, the FPGA's robustness has demonstrated itself to be pretty decent. Along with these issues, there are 15 or so other issues which are being addressed in the current Kickstarter 2 board design. Onto the first issue, the PS2 interface, where you would plug in your PS2 mouse or keyboard, or even both if you have a PS2 splitter. ESD protection diodes have been added, and level translation has been switched over to use FETs on all of the signal lines. An FET is a field effect transistor, and that is an electrical field is used to determine whether the transistor is on or off, and the level translation is done by arranging the FET such that it turns off if the voltage rises above 3.3 volts on the 3.3 volt side. And here we're talking about the point I mentioned just before, to bring the voltages down to the 3.3 volts that the FPGA is designed to operate with. A fuse has also been added on the PS2 interface to the 5 volt supply, and also capacitance has been added in order to reduce the conducted EMI. On to the next thing, and that is the VGA aspect of the board. Again, as with the PS2 interface, ESD protection diodes have been added, as has capacitance again, in order to reduce the EMI footprint. As a result of that, the analog RGB VGA signal on the new Kickstarter 2 boards is much cleaner than it is for the issue 2 boards, due to there being much less noise on the board. Now we come on to the Pi-0 GPIO interface. On the issue 2 board, the FPGA lines are connected directly to the Pi-0's GPIO. If the FPGA side and the Pi-0 side are programmed to simultaneously drive opposite signals on a particular GPIO line, this is effectively creating a short, and this could damage the Pi-0 driver. It's likely that it would fail before the FPGA, because the FPGA has some protection in its I/O drivers, and they have a higher strength than those of the Pi-0. So what's been done in this case is 200 ohm resistors have been added to all of the GPIO signal lines, and this limits the maximum current down to what the Pi-0 can tolerate when the two sides drive opposite signals. Next up is the combined EMI and the 3.5mm audio jacks. And again, as with the PS2 and VGA connectors, ESD protection diodes have been added in addition to capacitance in order to reduce the EMI. And the ear circuit has been found to be less sensitive than the original Spectrum models. The circuit used comes from one of the original issues of the Spectrum. And it's been used in other clone boards as well, but there seems to be maybe some misunderstanding about how it operates, because the ULA applies analog bias to improve the actual signal capture. So what's been done in this case is that the signal diode, it's a 1N4148, has been changed to a BAT54WS7F shot key diode. The forward voltage drop has been halved, which allows the tape audio to impress a bigger signal. Next up is the internal audio, the optional beeper. The Issue 2's optional beeper interface, which was through J3, was only ever intended to drive a speaker that was fully on or off, just as the original 48K Spectrum was. But this changed when it was decided to offer the option to send all of the audio through the internal speaker. The on-off driver is a BC848 transistor, and that has a maximum IC of 100 milliamps. IC is basically the collector current, and that's from a supply of 3.3 volts. This means that the minimum speaker impedance should be about 30 ohms, but this is still considered quiet by a lot of people who've carried out the speaker addition on their Nexts. When all the audio is sent through the internal speaker, not just the beeper, the thing gets worse because there's no feedback. The FPGA has to operate the transistor in an open loop manner, driving a base voltage in a quite a tight range around 0.8 volts to operate it in active mode. Because the full audio signal includes different sources, it's rarely ever operating near the full volume, so the signal's quiet. On the Issue 2, the only solution is to introduce an amplifier and use a higher voltage source on the board to increase the volume. But on the Kickstarter 2 boards, a change was made to J3 that includes a 5V voltage source. A change has also been made to J3 to add base, collector and emitter connections, and the option to remove the transistor from the actual audio circuit, so that the FPGA can then drive a full swing audio signal. And that can be more easily amplified and provide a higher quality output. So that brings us onto the next issue, and this is one of the biggies. This is HDMI. When a display detects a HDMI source, it has to terminate the HDMI signal lines in 3.3 volts. Now, displays are supposed to remove this termination when the HDMI source disappears, but some displays don't do that. And on the Issue 2 boards, there is a DC path from the HDMI display's 3.3 volt termination through the signal lines and into the FPGA. This can act as a weak power supply to the board, so even when you remove the power, there is some power getting through to the board. This can keep certain things alive on the board, so that when you're rebooting it, you get odd effects. It was termed back power, and many people will know they've been advised when they're rebooting their Nexts, if this happens, they need to remove the power and the HDMI to get a proper switch off. Back power prevents the machine from fully turning off, and can also lead to odd effects, such as the FPGA failing to reboot at power-up. To resolve this, series capacitance has been introduced onto the HDMI signal lines in order to block the DC power from coming from the display, and a dedicated IC has been added to PI3HDX12211, and that acts as a HDMI buffer, and it drives the HDMI signal off-board. While we're on the subject of HDMI, I just wanted to mention the NGO board. The NGO board is based on the Issue 2B Next board, and was created by Manuel Fernandez Higueras. And that has fixes in place to correct the HDMI back power, and it also adds some ESD protection for the HDMI interface. Obviously, I have the Pi Zero installed at the moment, which is blocking all of the HDMI stuff, but this NGO is the best route in at the moment to Next ownership. And even though they are suffering from the same issues that we are with part shortages, they are getting Spartan 6s kind of trickling through here and there, but the prices have gone up significantly. Next up is the expansion bus, and as with other aspects I've talked about ESD protection, diodes have been added, in addition to level translation for all of the signals using SN74LV4225s, 74LVX4245s, and SN74LVC1G14DCKR parts. Also, fixing the incorrect polarity of the bus rec signal. Most signals can reverse direction under CPU control and can also reverse direction when an external bus master controls the bus. Proper use of bidirectional buffers are necessary to accommodate both, with direction control by a new FPGA signal bus. Some signals are decoupled using FETs, again, int, reset, and bus request, and calculated pull-up and pull-down resistors were added to match the original Spectrum bus characteristics. Compromise did have to be made for compatibility with legacy peripherals, since these resistances do slow down signals for speeds greater than 3.5 MHz, should that be supported. Special attention is paid to the int, which on the original machines could be driven high by external peripherals, and that would override the ULA's interrupt. This was not possible to do with a single signal line, so the issue 4 boards have two int signals, output from the ULA and input from the expansion bus. And circuitry allows external legacy peripherals of period driver strength to override int through the int input path. The FPGA driver is too strong really for external peripherals to override the single int line on the issue 2 boards. Instead, this and these other fixes would need to be applied via some kind of aftermarket add-on plugged into the expansion bus of issue 2 machines. Bus loading issues were seen when some combinations of multiple peripherals were plugged into the issue 2 expansion, and one way this manifests is in ghost key presses detected from the expansion bus. When external pull-ups on the data lines, further burdened by added capacitance from attached peripherals, aren't fast enough to pull higher than 2 volts during an I/O read on port FE. This also happens on original Spectrums, but is made worse on the issue 2 due to the expansion bus being 3.3 volts. It's expected the move to 5 volts and level translation will improve this. Now onto the expansion bus voltages, primarily the 12 volt DC, 12 volt AC, and the minus 5 volt DC. Various Spectrum models do not have 100% consistent expansion bus, and this leads to some peripherals not working on all models. And the aim of the Spectrum Next expansion bus is to support the widest variety of peripherals directly, and it's largely based on the 48K expansion bus. So 3 voltages, as I mentioned before, are not available on the issue 2 expansion bus: the 12 volt DC, 12 volt AC, and minus 5 volt DC. The minus 5 volt DC isn't really important. The 2 12-volt sources, though, are used in a few peripherals, and unfortunately they would require special circuitry to generate. So for the purposes of the issue 4, it was decided to leave it in the same position as the issue 2, i.e. we're not supplying these sources mainly due to cost considerations. So instead, an aftermarket DIY module could be made available to generate those voltages for those who need them. And the issue 4 board circles the expansion bus voltage sources in the through-hole CN5 header so that necessary connections to such a board can be easily identified. Continuing the expansion bus thread, protection's been added against damage to peripherals and the computer through the expansion bus's 9 volt line. 9 volt can either be supplied by the computer's power supply to the expansion bus, or an external peripheral could power the computer through the 9 volt on the expansion bus. And no matter the source, incorrect polarity should not damage either attached expansion bus peripherals or the computer itself. So the following things have been done to prevent damage to the computer or a peripheral through the expansion bus: a fuse has been in line in the 9 volt expansion bus path. 9 volts from the expansion bus can power the computer, but only if it is correct polarity. 9 volts from the computer can power the expansion bus, but again, only if it's the correct polarity. And power supplied via both paths simultaneously is accommodated. And that brings us nicely onto the power supply itself, and what changes have happened there on the new Kickstarter 2 issue 4 boards. Noise and EMI suppression have been added to the supply line Fuse protection has been added to the supply line. Polarity protection, so that the supply of incorrect polarity does not cause damage. We've replaced the cut trace found in the original issue 2 for optional switch with a through-hole 0-ohm resistor that is easy to remove. And we've added 2 more through holes for 9 volts after the switch position for easy access to power by third-party internal add-ons. Next up is the voltage regulator. The original issue 2 board is underpowered when peripherals have high transient demands or when you've got a lot of peripherals plugged in at once. So we've replaced the issue 2 voltage regulators with a TPS 65261, which can deliver a higher current load to 5 volts, 3.3 volts and 1 volt rails. The RTX7, the FPGA in the issue 4, has an additional 1.8 volt rail, which is supplied by a separate linear regulator off the 3.3 volts. And also, more attention is now paid to power supply sequencing, in other terms, what order the power supplies come up and power on. Now, one of the major differences you can see from visually inspecting the new boards is the removal of the RAM chips in favour of a single chip. Signal integrity issues in the SRAM interface have added a great deal of difficulty in getting good builds for the FPGA because of how displays that are incompatible with the Spectrum are being accommodated. So the system clock, and therefore the memory cycle, varies from 27 MHz to 33 MHz, and scope measurements show that when we do get bad builds, they often don't drive signals sufficiently or timed well enough to successfully drive the SRAM at all the system frequencies, particularly towards the higher ones. Although the interface from the FPGA end has been improved given these insights, the problem has reappeared more frequently as the Spartan 6 chip has filled up and you get routing congestion on the chip. It was also discovered by Hoglett, who is the creator of the BBC Micro Core for the Next, and BBC cores for many other things as well, that FPGA configuration generated stray SRAM cycles and it contaminated memory. And this is a big problem because the Spectrum Next starts new cores by first initializing the SRAM memory for the next core, and then that core is started via FPGA configuration. And Hoglett spotted a pattern such that only certain regions of SRAM were affected. And in response, the address lines of the SRAM interface were shuffled so that all even 256K blocks in SRAM would be preserved across FPGA configuration. So in the issue 4, the replacement of the 4 SRAM chips with a single 1 meg x 16 SRAM chip, which is located next to the FPGA, should address signal integrity issues and also reduce cost, and the 16-bit character of the memory interface is then preserved. The other issue with ensuring that the FPGA doesn't inadvertently generate memory cycles during configuration, so that all of the SRAM contents are preserved across configuration, the RTX 7 has a signal that basically holds all of the pins high during configuration, and this is being made use of to resolve that particular issue. The next topic is FPGA flashing and the characteristics of the Spartan 6 and the RTX 7. The RTX 7 bit streams are 4 times larger than that of the Spartan 6, and after consideration for costs, it was decided to double the flash memory size to 256 megabit from 128 megabit. And this will accommodate a reasonable 14 cores on flash on the issue 4 boards, compared to the 32 that can exist on issue 2. 32 is considered fairly excessive, I guess, so we're not really losing anything there in being able to accommodate 14 cores on the RTX. However, this does pose a number of challenges because 128 megabit is the maximum flash size that can be addressed by normal 24-bit SPI addresses, and the step to 256 megabit means that a new protocol has to be used using 32-bit SPI addresses. So both hardware and software on the Spectrum Next needs to be able to accommodate this difference. Now we're going to shift focus to the keyboard membrane, as I mentioned at the beginning, the top of the shop, about the EMI. It was one of the three big talkers, I guess you could say. So additional capacitance has been added to all of the signals in order to reduce high frequency noise. Next, we switch over to the daughterboard, which was another one of the big three hitters. And one of the things I showed in the previous video, showing the differences between, I think, issue 3 and 4, it was found that the ribbon cable that connected the main board to the daughterboard is a significant source of electromagnetic interference. And this is due to the large loop areas in the cable caused by the separation of signals and ground and voltage sources. Improvements have been made to that. Addition of a 3.3 volt supply filter. We've added ESD protection diodes. We've added capacitance to reduce the conducted EMI. And we've also changed to a ZIF cable from the ribbon cable. And the ZIF cable has 16 lanes that can alternate signals and grounds in order to reduce the loop area. And although digital noise rejection for long button presses was incorporated into the FPGA for issue 2, analog noise rejection was also added for issues 3 and 4. Next up is the big noisy chatty Wi-Fi, which many people will have complained about in the past. I think it's safe to say it's a very noisy beast, and you get those kind of pop, pop, pops going on. And the only way really to get around it is to switch the Wi-Fi off with a reg command if you're not using it. The original issue 2 uses the ESP01 module, and that module would not pass CE in a million years. Its location on the PCB means that the antenna can place high frequency noise into nearby PCB traces. The periodic clicking noted by many users I've just mentioned is caused by the ESP transmitting to the Wi-Fi router, which causes a sudden draw of current on the 3.3 volt line, and that causes the 3.3 volt supply voltage to sag, and the sagging leads to the clicks in the audio out, and the degree that this happens depends on the model or the firmware of the ESP module, as there are several flavors out there of both hardware and software. So to resolve this particular issue, we've replaced the existing ESP module with a compatible ESP12F, which is both CE and FCC certified. We've moved the module to the right side of the PCB, so the antenna is away from the PCB traces, or at least the impressionable PCB traces. And we mitigate the supply drop by one of two methods: additional capacitance and resistive choke to the main 3.3 volt line, or a dedicated linear regulator for the ESP module. The latter is both recommended by Expressif and is the more expensive route. Currently, it's the capacitance method that is being used, but of course, these things are subject to change. The Arctic 7 does have spare I/O pins available, and the ESP12F exposes more signals, including things like hardware handshaking signals, CTS and RTS for the serial interface. It's just worth noting that due to the changes in the Wi-Fi, because it's now mounted directly to the board, it cannot be removed. The option that was available on the issue 2 boards, where the ESP module can be pulled out and replaced with a serial link to a PC, that option is no longer there. We haven't abandoned the DIYers out there though, because although the ESP module is soldered to the board, CN9 is present, and there's a signal on that in order to disable the onboard ESP. So you could still create a serial interface to a PC. Now, I'll probably be telling you things that you already know here, because obviously one of the fundamental differences in the issue 4 is the use of a different FPGA. And this was related to semiconductor shortages, which has led to increased prices, extended lead times, but it's particularly affected parts that cannot be easily substituted. And that includes things like FPGAs, microcontrollers, processors, GPUs, etc. So Xilinx lost access to the fab where the Spartan 6 was being manufactured. and wasn't able to make more until things returned to normal in the industry. And the estimate was around 2 years. So Xilinx's advice has been for Spartan 6 users to migrate, which may lead to a premature transition to end of life for the Spartan 6 down the line. After considering all of the options from Xilinx, Altera, Lattice, the Arctic 7 was selected. It's very similar architecturally to the Spartan 6. It's from the same manufacturer and uses similar synthesis software. It's only slightly larger in terms of capacity, but it adds a great deal of confidence that the same source code will be portable and cores can be easily built for both the A7 and the S6 and work on both. Even though the A7 is currently being produced, the lead times are a year long and there's nothing really we can do about that. So in order to facilitate the Arctic 7 coming in, obviously there's been a redesign of the PCB to cut the time off, you know, in terms of, well, waiting for a Spartan 6 will take a hell of a lot longer, and modifying the hardware and software in order to transparently support both issue 2 and issue 4 boards. The Arctic 7 has an additional feature, two built-in 12-bit 1 MSPS analog to digital converters, and MSPS in this case means mega samples per second. ADC conversion isn't a feature though of the Spectrum Next, so this functionality has not been integrated into the issue 4 board, but instead three ADC channels have been exposed with connections available on the board on new via connectors J11, J24 and J22. And these connectors are for the experimenters and the DIYers out there who just like to play around with stuff. One particular application in our mind is maybe stereo audio sampling through the 3.5mm audio or the ear mic jack. So now onto the joystick connectors, and as with the other connector types I've mentioned earlier, we've added ESD protection diodes, capacitance to reduce the conducted EMI. We've added series resistances for hot plugging. The joystick connectors on the Next are Sega standard, which is an extension of the digital Atari standard, which allows for up to 11 buttons to be read from a controller. All 11 buttons can be read by the Spectrum Next, and the interface remains compatible with the standard digital Atari stick with up to 2 buttons. Amstrad introduced, as people will know, a non-standard joystick interface for the Plus 2 and 3 in order to sell custom joysticks to consumers. They were a bit rubbish. Joysticks designed for this non-standard interface will short the plus 5 volt supply to ground on a Sega connector. When one of the directions is pushed, and some people have observed this, it causes the machine to reset. We've added a short circuit fuse to the 5 volt line to avoid machine reset when these incompatible devices are plugged in. So that brings us to the end of the list of improvements between the issue 2 and the issue 4. At least the improvements that the team can remember. I don't know if there's anything else kind of hidden away in the mists of time. But thanks for listening.